Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Welcome to topic 5.1, the basic concept of CPU scheduling. The objective of multi-programming is to have some process that running at all times to maximize CPU utilization. So the first basic component of a CPU scheduling is CPU input-output burst cycles. The process executions consists of cycle of CPU executions and input-output rate. So process execution begin with a CPU burst that is followed by an input-output burst, which is followed by another CPU burst that is belong to other process, then another input-output burst. Eventually, the final CPU burst end with a system request to terminate execution. So the duration of CPU burst has been measured extensively. So we look at the next figure. So the curve of this histogram is in exponential form. A CPU bound program might have long CPU might have a few long CPU bursts. An input-output bound program typically has many short CPU bursts. So this we look back at this statement. So these distributions can be important when implementing a CPU scheduling algorithm. Okay, we look at the second component of CPU scheduling, that is CPU scheduler. Okay, CPU scheduler select from among the process in ready queue and allocates a CPU core to one of them. So a ready queue can be implemented as first in, first out queue, a priority queue, a tree, or simply an unordered linked list. Okay, so from this point onwards, okay, it is belong to the third component of CPU scheduling, that is preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling. So a CPU scheduling decision may take place under the following four circumstances. Okay, the first one, number one, switch from running to waiting state, switches from running to ready state. Number three, switches from waiting to ready state. And the last one is terminates. Okay. For situation one and four, there is no choice in terms of scheduling. So for situation two and three, however, there is a choice. So a new process must be selected for the executions. Okay, so when scheduling take place under circumstances 1 and 4, the scheduling scheme is known as non-preemptive. So otherwise, it is a preemptive. So what is the difference between these two? So under non-preemptive scheduling, so once the CPU has been allocated to a process, the process keep the CPU until it release, either by terminating or by switching to the waiting state. Okay, so virtually all modern operating system, including Windows, Mac OS, Linux, and Unix, use preemptive scheduling algorithm. Okay, so for preemptive scheduling algorithm, it can result in race condition. So what is race condition? So race condition happen when data are shared among several processes. So this issue will be explored in detail in chapter 6, okay, in synchronization chapter. Okay, the last component of CPU scheduling is dispatcher. So dispatcher give control to the CPU to the process that has been selected by the CPU scheduler. Okay, this involve switching con- switching context from one process to another. So look at this figure. This is the context switching that we have already learned in chapter 3. Okay, this function also involves switching to user mode, okay, and jumping to the proper location in the user program to restart. Jumping to the proper location in the user program to restart that program. Okay, so the dispatcher should be as fast as possible since it is invoked during every context switch. Okay. The time it takes for dispatcher to stop process, so for example here, process P0 and start another running is known and start another running process is known as dispatch latency. Okay. So as a conclusion, okay, we already discussed four components involved in CPU scheduling. Okay, which are CPU burst distributions, CPU scheduler, preemptive and non-preemptive scheduling, and dispatcher. So inshallah, we will continue with topic 4.5.2, scheduling criteria. Thank you for watching.